Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to all of you to the Swedish Institute of International Affairs, Utrikespolitiska Institutet, and to this seminar on the European Union and its role in the world and specifically in migration. In the first half of 2014, 330,000 asylum applications were recorded in the industrialized countries, the majority of these in the EU countries. At the same time, the concept of migration within the European Union has been under debate lately. So we're looking forward to a very interesting seminar and discussion today about the EU's role in the world, about its responsibilities, about common asylum policies, about labor migration, and also about what we might expect from the future. My name is Victoria Veres, and I'm editor-in-chief and associated advisor here at the Institute, and I'm very happy to welcome such a distinguished panel here today. A warm welcome to Karolina Lindholm Billing, UNHCR, to Petra Hertzfeldt Olsson, Uppsala University, P.O. Hansen, Linköping University, and to our very own Roderick Parks, researcher here at the Institute. I look forward to your introductory presentations and to an interesting discussion after that. And at the end, we'll also open up for questions from the audience. And we really hope that you like to take part and make this discussion even more interesting with your thoughts and your questions. So please remember your questions and keep them, and we'll open up for that at the end. Before I introduce the first speaker, I'd like to give the word to Andrea Liebman, who is a strategic communications manager here at the Institute, who will tell you a little bit about an EU project that we're working on at the Institute right now, which is a bit unusual for us and which is linked to what we're talking about here today. So please, Andrea.
Hello. Can you hear me?
In 2012, four institutes in Europe were asked to work together to become sort of a platform for communications and debate on EU issues. The sister institutes, the other ones, we are one of them in Sweden, then it's Spain, Italy, and Poland. And it became a major cooperation platform for other partners all over the world. The result of this end of war ended up with a strategy document on European global strategy cooperation, and that is available. You may find it online on our website. Stemming from this, we're continuing this work, attempting to engage people and to create a discussion board. We have started a forum for young people, aged 18 to 24, and the entire project is in Swedish, so for those of you who only speak English in the audience, bear with me a little bit. I will translate as much as I can. And it's a bit of a pet project. We're going to see how this age group responds to questions, how they engage, if they're interested at all, which is actually the name of the project. Is called Who Cares About EU? And so we've taken this subject matter that's perhaps not the sexiest for this age group. We've turned the content into something that would spike their interest, so it's geared toward the age group as well. And we've created questions, we've done little video interviews with their peers in the city. We've created a quiz that they can answer questions on, and we're doing a little contest in the end of this project. It will last for 1 month. We're in the middle of it right now, and the purpose is basically to make these people feel like they have a say and that they can engage and that they can learn. we're not there to see if there is something good or bad or if anything is wrong with, but they can talk about it. So it's not, that's not what we try to do, is just to be a platform for this discussion. And this project was funded by the Swedish Agency of Youth and Civil Society, I should say as well. I just wanted to show you a little bit of what the content is about. And once this is over, we will take these findings and we will have to present a report to our funder and to all parties interested as well. We've chosen to present it on the social media platform Facebook, because that's where most people spend time, especially this age group. So we know that we can find them there. For example, I will start off by showing you a short video. I'll go down to one of the first ones. And as I mentioned, we interviewed young folks in the city, and we tried to reach different demographics and different areas so that we can get voices from different facets of society. And so we asked them about international cooperation, law, freedom, peace, TTIP, and so on. And here you can see what some of them said. What do you think about when you hear the word EU? That was the initial question.
Jag tänker på raka gurkor och vilket dumt beslut det var.
Jag tänker på ett internationellt samarbete. Jag tänker på att de flesta nationerna i Europa samarbetar som en slags superstat med ett gemensamt lagsystem.
Jag tänker på tillhörighet, frihet och gemenskap.
Då tänker jag framförallt på fred, men också att det är samarbeten mellan Europas länder, att man också har samarbeten till exempel olika bytesaffärer mellan kanske USA och Europa och underlättar för frihandel och sådana saker.
Gemenskap? Jag tänker bara på den blå flaggan. Stjärnorna och grejer, det är allt som ligger upp.
Ett samarbete mellan länder.
En massa möten med kostymklädda människor.
So you see, it's quite a variety. And it was very interesting. We spent a whole day out there. And what kind of hit me was that there's not that many that care. But then when you, they don't think they care. But then when you start asking questions and try to get something out of them, them, as if it's some foreign group. But then they engage and then they have something to say. We've seen quite a lot of responses. Some other questions, I'll just make this brief. Which is the most important issue do you believe that EU is working with right now? It's a great variety, but of answers. But most of them talk about the environment, animal rights, employment for young people, and human rights. Importantly, LGBTI rights. If they care, they said not at all. EU has not banned bullfighting. Interesting. That sometimes it's sort of something came out like that that I find interesting. I hope that you do as well. So I don't care. Or yes, because the EU can protect us against ISIS. And what do you think of when you hear the word EU? Some of them said dictatorship, decadence and unnecessary costs, and versus other ones said peace. And they also, some talked about richer EU countries taking on economic responsibility for poorer countries, and that's a problem. So we are not quite sure. As I said, we're in the middle of it. We're not quite sure what we'll find and what deductions we'll take, but we will work closely with the research department to see if there's anything interesting that can come out of it. So, and if you're interested in this, you can contact me at the Institute. And if you know of teachers or anyone 18 between 18 and 24, you can direct them to this Facebook page, Vem bryr sig om EU. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrea. I think actually it's interesting to hear some of the words that I'm sure we will pick up on during the discussion about belonging and freedom, peace, unity, cooperation, employment, also suits and cucumbers, of course, which we may not touch on. But it's interesting to keep in mind that this is the next generation. And we'll talk a lot about the future, I think, and what we will see coming on these issues. So we'll move straight on and give the word to Karolina Lindholm-Billing, who is the Deputy Regional Representative for Northern Europe at UNHCR. Please, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you so much for inviting me to speak here, and thank you all for coming here this afternoon. The focus of today's seminar is on the EU. I will start with just a few words about the situation in the world in terms of forcible displacement and how it impacts on us within the EU. Because in June this year, UNHCR, as we do every year, released our annual Global Trends Report. And that report showed that for the first time since the Second World War, more than 51 million people are forcibly displaced in the world. The majority forcibly displaced within the boundaries of their home countries, and then the others as refugees in countries abroad. 86% of the world's refugees find themselves in developing countries. And there, I think Syria is in case in point. Syria is right now the biggest refugee-producing country in the world. Over just a bit more than 3 years, more than 3 million Syrians have become refugees in primarily the neighboring countries of Lebanon, Jordan, Turkey, Egypt, Iraq. And 6.5 million Syrians have become internally displaced within the borders of their country. That's 9.5 million plus people forcibly displaced within a bit more than 3 years. It corresponds to the whole population of Sweden. And I mean, I personally find it very, even if I've worked with these issues now for so many years, find it difficult to comprehend. At the same time as it's the daily reality, the daily life for these people, and that behind all these staggering figures are women, men, children like us, mothers, fathers, and sisters and brothers. And in this crisis that I think we see today in the world when it comes to conflict and wars and lack of peace and solutions in sight, the principle of international responsibility and burden sharing is as important as ever. This is a principle which I think we often hear referred to. It's important to show international solidarity, but it is a principle that is a cornerstone, really, of the international refugee protection regime. It's mentioned in the preamble to the 1951 Refugee Convention. It's also mentioned in numerous conclusions on international protection by UNHCR's Executive Committee, which is our governing body. And so it has a legal weight to it. And in concrete terms, it means, of course, that states need to provide humanitarian funding to these, for example, 86% of the world's refugee hosting countries, so that they can continue to keep their borders open and provide protection to those who come to their country. It also means providing development assistance to refugee hosting countries, so the gap between humanitarian aid and development can be bridged. It also means upholding the right to asylum in our countries, like Sweden, so that we don't close our borders and our asylum systems. It also means, for example, accepting refugees on resettlement to our countries, and what UNHCR is advocating for in Europe at the moment, looking at other legal avenues to enter EU countries to obtain asylum protection here. And to exercise international solidarity and burden sharing, of course, can concretely, practically help countries like Lebanon to expand its medical care, education facilities, water, sewage systems, all of these things that need to be rapidly expanded to absorb and be able to take care of the increasing population it has received over the past 3 years. But it's also a very important political signal, because if we expect countries like Lebanon and Jordan to continue keeping their borders open, it does not send, it's important that we show that we can also accept a share of those who have been forcibly displaced. In October this year, UNHCR launched something called the Central Mediterranean Sea Initiative, CMSI, and it was a reaction to the Lampedusa tragedy a bit more than a year ago, when more than 600 people perished on the Mediterranean Sea in two boats that capsized. And it's also part of UNHCR's global strategy on rescue at sea. And when the Lampedusa tragedy occurred, it was really a wake-up call for the EU. There were many strong statements that this must never happen again. Now Europe must act together, stand united, and prevent further deaths at sea. Because it's a shame that people who have managed to cross the borders of Syria and escaped bombings, torture, then die while trying to exercise their right to seek asylum, which is a human right. But since then, since Lampedusa happened, actually since the beginning of 2014, almost 3,400 people are known to have died, drowned in the Mediterranean. 185,000 people being rescued at sea while trying to enter the EU to seek asylum. And this compares to 60,000 in the whole of 2013. So the number has just increased. And this is a direct reflection of what I started with by saying, that there are more conflicts, persecution, reasons for people to flee than ever. That's one reason. Another is, of course, that the protection standards in neighboring countries are becoming insufficient because of just the sheer number of people, and a lack of legal migration channels to Europe, apart from resettlement, which only very few compared to the global needs can obtain. So, within this global CMSI initiative, UNHCR is looking at what can be done in countries of origin to prevent people from having to flee, the human rights protection there. In the countries of first asylum, often in the neighboring region, and within EU member states. And in EU member states, we are advocating for joint EU search and rescue operations on the Mediterranean Sea, which has been, of course, a hot topic in recent days with the recent launch of the Frontex operation on the Mediterranean. And also to enhance the legal avenues to come to Europe to seek asylum, because at the moment, the only ones who benefit from the current system are human smugglers and human traffickers who make a lot of money from due to the desperation of people and their need for protection. And these legal channels can include increased possibilities for family reunification with family members in EU countries, private sponsorship schemes, and labor migration, for example. So I think I will end there. Thank you.
Thank you so much. This is so interesting, and we'll pick up on what you said more in the discussion. I just wanted to ask you one question, because you mentioned in the beginning the number of forcibly displaced people in the world right now, which was 51 million,
yep.
Is that right? How is that in a historical perspective? Have we seen these numbers before?
No, actually, I mean, since the Second World War, this is the highest figure. And UNHCR, when we released this Global Trends report, we said if all these people would be comprised a nation, it would be the 26th largest nation in the world. And I think, I mean, me, again, personally, having worked for many years for UNHCR in different countries, I think, you know, we really feel it very strongly. And I think that what is very worrying is that there are very few, to reverse this trend requires political solutions. I mean, humanitarian response and refugee protection, it's like a band-aid to a bleeding wound. It's political solutions that will, enable people to return to their home countries, repatriate, and prevent more people from having to flee. So, but there are few political solutions in sight to the conflict in Syria, in Iraq, South Sudan, Central African Republic. These are the big level 3 humanitarian emergencies in the world right now. And then, of course, there are many other countries from where people flee.
Thank you. We'll come back to that later again. Thank you. And we'll move on slightly, connecting, of course, to this, to labor migration and migration from third countries. And I'd like to give the word to Petra Hetzfeld-Olsson, who is a senior lecturer in international law, international labor law, at Uppsala University. Please.
Thank you very much, and I'm also very delighted to have been invited to this really interesting seminar. And as Karolina was talking that we need new ways into the European Union, I will talk about one of those new ways is the labour migration road into the European Union. And the outline, I will say a few words about the background to this development, and then the conflicting interests that have been involved in the development on a new legal regime on labour migration, and also finally say a few words about the result. So the turnabout was in 1999 when the European Council met in Tampere, and when the EU for the first time spelled out a common need for labor from third countries. And you must remember this was many years before the crisis. The new goal was to attract economic migrants from third countries. And at this point, one of the problems was that EU intra-movements had not led to the necessary allocation of workers to the results needed. So how to proceed? Well, the EU had to change perspective. And it was decided in Tampere in 1999 that the EU should develop a common legislative framework on labour migration from the outside. And the purpose was that harmonisation of this legislative framework would help to attract migrants to the European Union. We'll skip this. So, but why? Well, the scenario had changed due to demographic development and skill and labor shortages, which was at that point present in the European Union. And that was also something which was put forward by the Commission. But I must also say that this is questioned by some scholars, if this is the right way to deal with these problems. But But still, labor from third countries was needed in order to make EU the most competitive and dynamic knowledge-based economy in the world. You all recognize this story. In order to promote economic development and also maintain the level in the welfare systems. So the arguments were quite powerful. So one question as we must ask ourselves is of course, why should EU deal with these issues? Why couldn't the member states regulate these issues themselves? Well, the Commission argued that a common regulation would maximize the positive effects for the member states. One problem was when we compared the situation in the European Union, for example, to the situation in Canada, United States, and also Australia, that we did not attract the number of, in particular, highly qualified migrants as they did. There was something problematic with this, with the European system. And one of those problems was that there were 28 different, quite complicated and time-consuming procedures for getting into the European Union as a labor migrant. So, if we could agree on one simplified application procedure for all these 28 member states, then the situation would be much better. Another thing was that we needed a common set of rights to avoid unfair competition between the EU member states. The trust was not that high at this point. And also, of course, one idea was to facilitate movements between member states. That could not be; those issues could not be taken on a national level. But when the negotiations started on this, it turned out that the member states were not so convinced after all. Deciding who to let into the country is one of the most guarded aspects of sovereignty. So the Commission's first proposal was drawn back. Because in the first proposal, the Commission proposed that there would be common admission criteria for all kind of labor migrants, independent of what kind of category they belong to. But the member states thought that this would intervene too much in the member states' right to decide who to let into the country. So the conflicting interests here, it is of course that there was, at least, that was the argument, quantitative and qualitative need of workers in order to promote economic development and so on, versus, already at this point, high unemployment, which increased even more, inadequate migration of the present migrants, and also xenophobia. But there was another problem here, that was the fear for irregularity. Because in this process, the only thing that was discussed was temporary migration. And there was a strong belief among the stakeholders that temporary migration increases the risk for irregularity. So the solution was to also adopt a particular directive that would sanction employers who would employ irregular workers, and also to build in safeguards in the other new legal directives on legal migration. So this, of course, is a challenge with inherent moral problems. Because how should the right workforce be attracted without increasing the pressure on the national workforce and the national welfare systems? Is it possible to turn migration on and off like a tap? That was the question the member states stood in front of. So the risks here, is that the third country nationals would be treated more like economic units than human beings. So the solution here was a new policy plan from 2005. The Commission had been involved in deep discussions with all the stakeholders because they didn't want to fail this time. And the result was this kind of fragmentation. So there would be one horizontal directive which will deal with a facilitated admission procedure, but no admission criteria. So the member state will still decide on what basis a person would be allowed to get into the country. And there would also be a common set of rights for these workers. But there will be four sector-specific directives, including admission criteria. That would be for those workers who conducted work as the EU citizens could not do, or as the EU citizens were not willing to do. So with the results so far is a number of new directives, and the last two ones were adopted this spring, the directive on seasonal workers and on intra-corporate transferees. But we also have the single permit directive, and we also have a directive on researchers, and of course the important directive from the negotiators' point of view on sanctions for employing irregular workers. So the result so far is a very fragmented picture. All the different categories are provided with different sets of rights and different sets of admission criteria. And it's also a lot of margin of appreciation for the member states. So we can question, is this harmonization, will it be achieved, as was one of the pull factors for starting this initiative from the beginning. So we can also see that the directive on highly qualified workers, which was seen as a very important directive, that the Commission could not convince the member states to totally harmonize this regulation. And that means that there are parallel structures. We have this directive on highly qualified workers, which are granting a blue card for those who are admitted. But then there are parallel structures as well. And those member states who already have much more favorable structures, they of course keep them. So if we look at the number of blue cards have been admitted, for example, in the Netherlands and Austria, they are very, very few. But in relation to their traditional system, there are quite many thousands of them who are applied. But in Germany, it's the opposite. It has been a real success in Germany because they didn't had any structure for highly qualified workers before. So if we look for the future, a wish list, if we look at those directives and the content of this new legal framework, well, I would see that it would be more focused on safeguarding that the labor migrants are provided with the rights they are entitled to. And that's the question about how different immigration law and labor law interacts, which finally also is very important in order to safeguard these things. And if we talk about the seasonal workers, who is a quite vulnerable group, it would be wise to take out those provisions that promotes irregularity rather than the opposite. That would be, for example, to strengthen the right to circular migration in these directives, and also to delete the right to withdraw a permit due to employees' violations of the law. If we talk about highly qualified workers, there are really weak commitments to ethical recruitment in that directive. And that is also something that might be dealt with in the future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Petra. This was really interesting, and I just like to briefly to pick up on your wish list here about labor migrants being provided with the rights that they are entitled to. Could you give an example of what this could be?
Yeah, from they are. All the labor migrant groups are today provided with equality with regard to the national workforce. But for a seasonal worker, he or she can only stay in a member state for maximum 9 months, for example. And if there would be a problem with the employer, if the employer would not guarantee, not safeguard the rights there are, it's very difficult for the seasonal worker to ensure that these rights, that he or she is given those rights before the person has left the country, for example. And there is also a risk that if a person is complaining, the risk is that the person will lose the work permit. And in that case, they will no longer have the right to stay in the European Union. Mm-hmm. So there must be safeguards that it is possible to complain and not risking to lose a permit, for example. Mm. Two examples.
Good. Okay. Thank you. Sure. Thank you. We will move forward, and I'd like to give the word to Pio Hansen, who is Associate Professor at the Institute for Research on Migration, Ethnicity and Society at Linköping University. So please, Pio.
Thank you. I'm going to turn this on here. Or maybe I have a microphone here. Will they conflict?
You can just turn it maybe to the side. Yes.
You can hear me. Good.
First of all, a warm thanks to the Institute for this very kind invitation to talk on these important topics. What I will do here is to go inward and talk about the current crisis for free movement or the new migration crisis within the EU that you hear about every day, precisely as I speak. So my research has concentrated a lot on things like Petra talked about the external side of EU migration policy. And so what I wish to start by saying is to say that for the longest time, or until Eastern enlargement and until the crisis, the EU could project the so-called migration problem to the outside, and most often to the outside periphery, North Africa and so on. They still do that forcefully, but now the projection is also inside, an internal projection on EU citizens themselves. And this, of course, come in the versions of that we see daily with David Cameron and Angela Merkel and other governments attempt to infringe and to change free movement within the EU. So this is a big change. I was in the beginning of the summer, I was asked by the OECD to write a paper on the EU's labor migration policy from third countries, spanning the period 1999 to 2014. And it is amazing to go back and read the debate, the policy debate on migration between 1999 and 2007 and 8, before the crisis, and then to continue on into our own day and age, because it's a significant change. It's a huge. It's like a different universe almost with the crisis and what the crisis has done to migration and the migration dynamic. But let me begin then with the early crisis time and José Manuel Barroso's infamous statement where he said there is no such thing as a free lunch, there is also no such thing as a free deficit, sort of confirming the EMU fiasco. But also what this raises is, of course, if there is no free lunch and no free deficit, is there then free movement? And that is the big question, of course. But the crisis has done a lot. I will rush through because I know we are short of time. But just to see, this is just the recent youth employment rate, which show you this huge spread amongst the 28 member states, ranging from Germany's quite low youth unemployment rate to the very, very high of Greece. But it gives you a very fragmented picture, not so much about integration as fragmentation. The same thing about GDP, they have not converged as many thought that the EU would work towards. Instead, there is a tendency of disintegration in this area as well. You can see the darker areas are the more well-off, the lighter the less well-off. So what we have in some sense is a European integration that actually leads to European disintegration in a socio-economic way. People get poorer, people get richer, and so a conflict might be brewing. But the crisis then has led to an increase of movement within the EU, but also an increase of emigration from the EU as such. So this is the new emigration-immigration dynamic that I started off talking about. And we see this in the amazing figures from, for instance, Lithuania and Latvia, where close to 10% left the country between 2008 and 2013. This is what some migration scholars refer to as a demographic collapse. Ireland has also lost a lot of people, such as we see here. It is now in its fifth or sixth year of net migration. And the crisis is so severe now that the Irish state has instituted a special minister for the diaspora, which has as its his duty to try to bring people back home. We also have this figure from the Financial Times from Portugal. 200 young Portuguese are leaving Portugal every day. But we also see then a so-called brain drain within the EU, which relate a lot to Romania's doctors, but to nurses, to health personnel in general, which is basically bleeding Romania of doctors. And they, of course, end up in the richer parts of the EU. And this is an immigration that is not complained about from folks like David Cameron or Angela Merkel. Germany, on the other hand, has then experienced a huge increase of migration, and this time it's not from Turkey, it's from southern crisis EU countries and Bulgaria, Romania, and so forth. So there's been a lot of headlines claiming that the surge in immigration from crisis hit Europe is hitting Germany. And what this then has led to is that the crisis equals crisis for the institution of free movement as such. And then also a crisis for one of European integration's flagship achievements. And we see this in polls that confirm that a lot of people are very skeptical. There's a lot of opinion against the free movement system, maybe not always so much about immigration as about rights to those EU migrants. And of course, it's very important to note the language shift here, that now EU migrants is the common term used, whereas this was not the case just 10 years ago. We didn't have such a term. And the headlines have been many, you know of them. I will just go through, especially, and this is not only Britain. Germany, the Netherlands, Austria, and so on are full of these warnings and alarms about EU migrants coming. And now the latest row between first Barroso and Cameron, and now between Angela Merkel and David Cameron. And EU freedom of movement non-negotiable, says Germany, which is a truth with some serious modification, because Berlin, while they're saying this to Britain, is actually introducing legislation that will strip EU migrants of some of their rights. Legislation that might be blocked by the EU machinery, because it might be in violation of free movement provisions. And the four-country letter that you might have heard of last summer, where Britain, Austria, the Netherlands, and Germany made a frontal assault on the institution of free movement, arguing that the migrants, which was the only word used, that they were basically social tourists, welfare scroungers, and so on, and that, as the letter finished, all necessary measures need to be taken to deal with the consequences of this type of immigration and to fight its causes. This includes legal as well as financial measures. One of the most bold assertions here was, of course, to introduce re-entry bans. So in this sense, Angela Merkel and David Cameron are very much on the same page. And this was if you read this letter, you realize that the language used is actually the language that we know from migration policy towards North Africa, the Middle East, and so on. This is not the language we're used to being leveled against Europeans. And so it sounds very much like this type of language. We do not want uncontrolled immigration into our labor markets and our social security systems. This is a secret leaked document that came out right before the crisis in 2006, when Germany and France simply said that if we're going to have circular migration and labor migration from third countries, it has to be very, very carefully arranged, and making sure that these people leave as soon as their time's up. For the Commission, this is of course a crisis because it means that one of, as I said, one of the flagship achievements of the EU is under threat. So Cecilia Malmström, when she was the Home Affairs Secretary and in charge of migration, she simply said, "EU citizens who have the right to travel, live, work, and study wherever they want in the Union are put on a par with immigrants from countries outside the EU." So this is a scandal, right? For instance, they're being called EU immigrants, a concept that does not exist. They're mixing apples and oranges like anything. They're mixing up internal EU mobility and immigration. And Viviane Reding went the same way. She says, European citizens exercising the right to free movement are not immigrants. So you see the importance attached to language here, because if we start to call EU citizens migrants, then we know that free movement might be lost. So we have all these new ways of describing mobility and free movement inside the EU that in the end equals sort of EU immigration, EU immigrants, and then also to some extent has started to equal EU citizenship and EU citizens. Just a short on explaining the crisis of free movement. And the most basic, almost law-like explanation will be this, right? That growing socioeconomic disparities between countries lead to more migration control and restrictions. This is, I think it's almost the case. Although it's not always the case that people are actually migrating. But the controls and the restrictions will always come up between richer and poorer countries or regions. Whereas decreasing socioeconomic disparities between countries often leads to more of or less restrictions and so more free movement. They're mixing apples and oranges, says Cecilia Malmström. I would say they're not. They're simply starting to adopt and call for the same measures towards internal migrants as they and the European Commission have adopted towards external migrants. So remember, this is the Commission's language when it speaks about migration at the UN high-level dialogue, where it warns against uncontrolled migration, that it might aggravate security threats and so on. So here it is a totally different language again as compared to how the Commission talks about the internal situation. We can also describe this as that these countries calling for restrictions on free movement, that they're simply starting to adopt and call for the same measures towards the EU's internal periphery as they and the European Commission have already adopted towards the EU's external periphery. So is this core periphery, center periphery dynamic that is now opening up inside the EU, whereas previously it was core against periphery, but then with the periphery outside of the EU. And that is a key, I think, absolutely. So the question then is, if EU's external migration policy is starting to become internalized, of course there's a long, long way to go before that takes place. But we see the tendency, and I think those signals are very important to keep track of them. And I think one way is to go, as my final slides will show, the historical lesson of free movement. Because I don't want to give the impression that free movement was all fine and flowery prior to the crisis or Eastern enlargement. It's always been fraught with nervousness and tensions of free movement not being used in the right way. So let's go back to 1957 and the Treaty of Rome. You see Algeria here in pinstripes. Algeria was totally incorporated into the EEC or the EU in 1957 because it was part of France. One exception though, which the New York Times reported, Algeria will enter the EEC market on much the same basis as France, but Algerian labor will not share the freedom of movement of other labor in the six nations, nor will it receive wages or social insurances at European rates. This is the New York Times commenting in February 1957, when the six countries have agreed on the Treaty of Rome. So this is just to show how things were dealt with historically. That as soon as you have that core periphery relationship, and in Algerian case also a racial component and a strong geopolitical component, of course, too, because there was a very brutal war going on right at the moment of the Rome Treaty. But as soon as we have that, we see that free movement is not something to be taken for granted, but that, on the other hand, this has been the sort of the trajectory of the EU within this area from day one. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for an interesting presentation. I'd just like to jump back to something you said in the beginning about countries like Ireland, Latvia, Lithuania, who are experiencing brain drain at the moment. And I was wondering, are they turning a blind? You said about Ireland having this special minister, but does this mean that they are being more open to external migration, or are they turning a blind eye to the demographic challenges? Have you seen that?
I know too little. You should have asked my colleague Charles Wolfson about this, because he's the expert on the Baltics. But there's not so much going on there either. And on the other hand, migration from the Baltics continues, especially Latvia and Lithuania. And it's, of course, the figures are contested to some extent, and so on. But given that the countries come from such small populations to begin with, this is why it's so significant. Ireland doesn't have a big population either, and also that so many of the people leaving are precisely those that have, it's a mix, but a lot of them, like in Ireland, 60% of those leaving have university degrees. So what we see there is, of course, this brain drain aspect. I hate the word, but let's use it. Because there is a similarity here between the way we talked about, for instance, many African countries, as spending a lot of money educating nurses and doctors that then are just taken to North America and Europe. Now we see a similar tendency, or a similar sort of alarm sounding in European countries, in EU countries, saying that we spend all this money on these graduates and then they just leave because the policies we have, I mean, we saved the banks, what we didn't think about anything else, and these are the results. So.
Thank you. We'll move on and we'll talk a little bit more about challenges in the years ahead. And I'd like to give the word to Roderick Parks, who is a research fellow here at the Swedish Institute of International Affairs at the Europe Research Program. So please, Roderick.
Thank you. A warning, this is not going to be an elegant presentation, but I hope it will be instructive. A word of background, perhaps. I am at UE now, but a week ago I was still based in Poland, working for a think tank in Warsaw. One of my last tasks was to do a sort of SWOT analysis for Donald Tusk, who's the former Polish Prime Minister, and he's about to go off and chair the European Council in Brussels for the next 2.5 years. What he wanted was a sort of SWOT analysis, an analysis of upcoming challenges in the field of free movement. And this is what we came up with. It comes against the background of a little bit of, if not complacency in Brussels about the state of free movement, then certainly a desire for the status quo. The desire for the status quo rests, I think, on an understanding that free movement is a positive thing. And the EU for the last at least 10 years has had sort of four pillars to its free movement policy, trying to place its internal free movement regime in a sort of global context, and as a reaction to globalization and increased interdependence with its neighbors. These four strands have been first to try to build up the resilience of its internal free movement regime, the freedom to seek work in other member states, and also to travel freely without a passport. Secondly, to make sure that regime has robust border controls, so that the EU has a robust common border, but robust in the sense of being able to handle also large numbers of legal migrants, people wanting to come in legally to the EU. Thirdly, a growing desire to create a sort of regional zone of mobility, one that stretches from Russia in the east and throughout North Africa and the Middle East in the south. And fourthly, to try to put in place the building blocks for a global free movement regime. So to try to exploit the benefits of free movement globally. And what we found when we were putting together the scenarios, and that's all I'm going to do is just run through the scenarios so that you get a picture of what the upcoming political issues are as we see them, is that this idea of mobility, that's in the common good both of sending countries and receiving countries and migrants themselves. This idea that the EU has been pushing quite hard for the last 10 years is coming into serious conflict with changes in the nature of international relations, where you're seeing much more of a turn towards nationalistic thinking, zero-sum thinking, countries looking at migration issues not in terms of sort of common benefits, but very much in terms of population loss, prestige, ideological and geopolitical gain. And that's all I want to do is just run through these sort of four blocks of the EU's approach and flag up where the challenges will come from in the next 2 years, just to give you a sense of what the challenges we're facing are, because they're actually quite scary. And I will try to do that in my 10 minutes. So the first block, this idea of trying to make the free movement system more resilient, we've heard from Pierre that it's running into serious problems. The five scenarios that we put together here are just essentially looking at where restrictions to the free movement regime will come from. Two of them, I think, if you follow these issues, are quite obvious. One is a sort of localist alliance between the UK and Switzerland. Both of them look likely to vote in 2017 to have a national referendum on their relations to the European Union. And for both of them, it looks like free movement is going to be the key issue there. So that's the sort of main, sort of obvious political challenge is a possible alliance between the UK and Switzerland. And localist in the sense that they're saying, well, our citizens didn't vote for this, you know, we feel trapped in this regime. And the second one, I suppose, is a possible alliance between the UK and Nordic countries. And I know that the Nordic countries are more committed to this than the UK is, but because they have welfare systems with a universalist element to them, there's a conflict with free movement where people who haven't paid into an insurance mechanism get immediate access. So these are the two obvious sort of scenarios. But what we're also seeing is a possible alliance between the EU's sending countries and receiving countries. So countries like the UK and countries like Hungary that both say, well, perhaps our citizens, some of our citizens, our more mobile citizens, do benefit from this system. But we're worried about, in Hungary's case, losing our population, about, you know, a demographic crisis, what we were talking about. And the UK saying, well, you know, our population is growing too quickly. So you're seeing a sort of unholy alliance between sending countries and receiving countries over the heads of their citizens sometimes, and them appealing to the less mobile parts of their societies and saying, well, we're doing this for you. Equally, what you may see is a bit of an unholy alliance between countries like France and the UK, which seems an unlikely one initially, that they have very different views of these things. But you're seeing increasing alliances between protectionism and libertarianism on this issue. You're seeing that especially in the UK at the moment. A party like UKIP, the Eurosceptic Party, manages to cover both of these strands. So it says, we reject the free movement of labour on a sort of protectionist level because it's exposing us to immigration from the EU that we can't control, and it's hitting poor workers. But on a libertarian basis, we do as well, because it's forcing us to discriminate against the best workers from outside the EU. So you're seeing this strange alliance between protectionism and libertarianism, and that seems to be spreading out beyond the EU. But I think the last scenario we looked at, and perhaps the most likely challenge, is France pushing for a sort of Eurozone cooperation on free movement and breaking up the EU's free movement regime and saying those peripheral countries, the UK, Switzerland, Hungary, the new member states in the East, they may not be committed to free movement. But free movement has an important role in offsetting imbalances within the Eurozone. So we want a deeper Eurozone cooperation on free movement, which would involve deeper cooperation, for example, on wages. So again, this slightly protectionist inner core. So that was the first set of scenarios we looked at, that the idea of free movement in the common interests of EU states is sort of breaking down. You're seeing those alliances thinking in much narrower terms about things like population loss and so on. The second strand was the EU's border regime, its efforts to build up robust common borders and immigration and asylum regime. And what you're seeing there increasingly, and I think what we'll see increasingly over the next 2 years, is a sort of creeping geopolitics of border policy within the European Union. So member states using their geographical position in order to gain leverage over each other. And you're already seeing that, for example, in the first scenario that we looked at, which is the growing tension between the north of the European Union and the south, countries like Italy calling for solidarity from northern countries saying, well, we're not directly affected by the problems of refugees through the Mediterranean, and Italy saying, well, you know, we have ways of sharing this problem with you, you know, we can lift our border controls. So you're seeing that sort of split north-south already. But we looked at various other scenarios, for example, Italy threatening to suspend itself from the Schengen regime. Already under EU rules, member states can suspend one another from Schengen if they feel that, for example, Greece is not living up to standards. But what happens if a country suspends itself from Schengen? It essentially shifts the border northwards to other member states. I'm not saying that will happen, but the mere threat of that shifts the political balance and you see a certain geopolitics there. You're seeing the increasing threat, I think, of Germany going it alone. Germany, as we've heard, as I think in 2012 was globally the second most attractive country for legal migration. And most of that came from within the EU. That means that they have very little incentive to add to the EU's legal migration regime. So we may see Germany again going it alone on this, and it has the power to do so, and it has the point of attraction. We're seeing, interestingly, in the third of these scenarios, big and small countries ganging up together in order to sort of gain political leverage in Brussels. So big countries naturally have the most political say in Brussels, but a country like Malta is most affected by these countries, even if it doesn't have that leverage. So what you're seeing is alliances between countries like France and Malta trying to use their sort of geographic position in order to gain leverage in Brussels. And the last scenario we looked at here, and again is looking increasingly likely, is not the north-south split within the EU, but it's a three-way split over migration and borders between the north, the south, and the east. You have three completely different border regimes in the EU. You have in the west the largest airports, you have in the south this large sea border, and you have in the east this potentially difficult border to Ukraine, to Eastern Europe. And I think what you're increasingly saying is, seeing in Europe, is each of these sort of blocks saying, well, we don't feel that we're properly represented in the EU. And the south, during the difficult summer months when you have lots of refugees from the Mediterranean, trying to leverage that. Easterners, potentially, with the Ukraine crisis, trying to leverage that. And Westerners, who've created the entire system, trying to leverage their position. So that's the sort of second block that we're seeing, is a sort of creeping geopolitics in the EU around the issues of borders and migration. I'll be quick. I've just looked at the clock. The last two. The regional context. As I say, the EU had an idea of creating three zones of one zone of mobility that stretched out to the east to Russia and down to the south to North Africa and the MENA region. I'll perhaps just pick up one of the scenarios from that because we're running out of time. But what you're seeing there is instead of this one block of mobility, that it's essentially split into three blocks. So in the center you have, as ever, Schengen and the EU's free movement zone. But in the east, you have Russia looking at that and copying it for its own Eurasian Economic Union and saying the EU, essentially copying the EU's methodology, but understanding it in a different way. So saying this isn't about the common good, this is more about geopolitical gain, this is about controlling population flows and a large population. And in the south, you have a sort of de facto free movement zone because the borders are dissolving in the south, in North Africa and the Middle East. And you have regional powers like Iran, like Saudi Arabia, trying to control movements of people, trying to control the trapped populations there who can't get out for their own geopolitical gain. So that's perhaps the main scenario that we looked at there. The fact that this idea of a sort of free movement regime that stretches regionally has broken down into a sort of geopolitics of population and competition there. And perhaps just the last set of scenarios. As I say, the EU had an idea of promoting a global free movement regime, putting in place the building blocks for a sort of global free movement system. And what we're seeing there, as we're seeing in many other areas, is the effects of Western decline, the effect of the EU's declining influence there. So it's not just the fact that borders and border disputes are coming back and borders elsewhere, but also in the EU are being remilitarized. Another of the scenarios we looked at is the idea of what you call a sort of noodle bowl of competing free movement regimes. So instead of one global system, you're seeing various other regions trying to gain a competitive advantage by building their own free movement regimes in West Africa and Asia between the BRICS countries. And perhaps I'll just finish by pointing to the challenge to the refugee regime that comes from that. Our final scenario, that the refugee regime is based essentially on an idea that the world is heading in a liberal direction and that we in the West can grant temporary protection to people from countries that are moving on a slower path. As that sort of basic assumption breaks down and you're seeing much greater differentiation in other parts of the world, different political paths, and that basic assumption of the refugee regime breaks down and different countries will seek to impose their own ideologies on the refugee regime. So the whole idea of the international refugee regime, which we heard about in the first presentation, is beginning to break down. So these were my sort of four blocks of scenarios. I really just wanted to flag up the fact that the EU's idea of free movement as something in the common good, both for sending and receiving countries, is under serious threat, and we're falling into a much more zero-sum and nationalistic sort of competition around population and people flows. I'll stop there.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Roderick, for this interesting presentation, and thanks to all of you. I'd like to before we invite all of you for questions, just to discuss a little bit more, and I'd like to pick up on the challenges issue, and I'd like to invite all four of you to discuss this. I was, Karolina, you were referring to the crisis today, the refugee crisis, and really what we're seeing today is only the beginning. I'm thinking about, for example, the situation in Syria, that here in Europe we haven't really seen so much of that yet, even if we've started to see it, but the main routes are not coming from there yet, if I understand it correctly. So I would just like you to comment on, and maybe all four of you to comment on, what do you think we can expect and what needs to be done in the near future?
It's a difficult question, mm-hmm. and many with many answers, I think. I mean, maybe to start on your last point, that the international refugee regime is breaking down. I mean, yes or no? I mean, the EU has just a bit more than a year ago adopted what we call the second generation of the EU asylum acquis, a number of binding recast directives that member states are now in the process of transposing into their national legislation. This needs to be done by mid-2015. This is directive on asylum procedures, reception conditions, and so on. And so the legal framework is quite strong, I would say, within the EU, and the EU directives have helped to really strengthen the legal frameworks of EU member states like Latvia, Lithuania, that you mentioned. But the challenge, of course, is in the implementation, because there the standards differ a lot. And that's one reason why we also see within this intra-EU movement, we see a big intra-EU movement of asylum seekers and refugees. So our office, for example, covers the three Baltic countries, and these continue to be transit countries, especially since the global financial crisis hit the three Baltic states, in particularly Latvia and Lithuania, very hard in 2008, that even those who are granted asylum in these countries say, well, we are not able to survive here, so we feel compelled to make another forced movement within the EU in search of livelihoods for our survival, says recognized refugees in Lithuania and Latvia with whom we have spoken. And this, of course, is a challenge, because it's a challenge to then the whole common European asylum system within, you know, the migration system. So it's like you say, without political solutions in sight, the refugee migration or movement into the EU is likely to continue, and the pressure on the borders being increasingly big, and countries like Sweden, which just increased the target for this year today, I think, to 95,000. Of course, wants to see a more common share of responsibility within the EU, including by the Baltic countries. But of course, it's difficult when people who come there, asylum seekers and refugees, don't feel that that is a viable option for them. So more support to those countries, Italy, Greece, Hungary, Bulgaria, the Baltic states, is needed to enable them to become real countries of asylum and countries of migration. But it's not only money to build up institutions and capacity building, but also they need a kind of a share of migrant communities in order for others to want to stay. Mm. Because if you come and you're the only Somali in the entire country, and you're met with discrimination, xenophobia, intolerance, it's going to be difficult for you to remain and feel welcome there.
I'd like to ask actually all of you, and I know that this is like the impossible question to answer, the million-dollar question, but I'm going to ask it anyway because I'm a journalist and we do that. But what, from your different perspectives, if you were to very briefly just point out like the one most important thing that needs to be done within the European Union now, what would that be to work for a good future? Petra, would you like to start? You're welcome.
I can of course only say that from the perspective I know something about, and that is labor migration and labor law. And I think the most important thing is to ensure that workers within Europe, that they compete on the same basis. I think that is one of the most important things from my perspective now, and ensure that people are really guaranteed the rights they are supposed to have, and try to hinder unfair competition between workers within the European Union.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Pia, what would you say from your perspective?
I mean, given what you just said, my sort of spinal cord reaction would be to deal with especially the Mediterranean, but borders in general. This is the most acute thing, that so many people are dying. Mm-hmm. From trying to get in and seek a safe haven. So, but if there was little interest in that, in doing and facilitating that prior to the crisis, there is even less now. Although there are certain signs. I mean, the initiative by the Italian government after Lampedusa was applaudable. I mean, that was fantastic. Now that is winding down because nobody is supporting it, and instead it's going to be replaced, something, by more militarization again via the EU and Frontex and so on. So it's again, it's the weird and it's the obscene, perverse effect that you see. Oh, here's a policy that actually saves about 100,000 people. That's not a solution. We have to stop that. And that we have to look at that, saying that the more people we save, that will become a problem. I mean, I don't have words for it, but that is certainly, I think, absolutely key, although I have little hopes that anything will come about, as we've seen with the successful Italian attempt.
Thank you. Roderick.
Let me start perhaps just by underlining what you said about what the future looks like, because I think we haven't seen anything yet. We heard the figure of 9.5 million people displaced in Syria. We've had, 165,000 asylum applications. I think what we discussed this earlier today, I think what we're seeing with people coming across the Mediterranean is that they are people who've been displaced by earlier conflicts. We're not feeling the Syria conflict yet. We're seeing Palestinians and Eritreans who now see no point in going home. We see East Africans who were probably heading towards Saudi Arabia or Israel and have been deflected by immigration restrictions there and sort of passed on to the EU. We see people who are already in Libya on a sort of pay-as-you-go method of getting to the EU, so you work for a bit and you pay the next step of your path, who now see that they can't work any longer in Libya, but the smugglers are taking ever greater numbers of people. But what we're not seeing yet is the people from Syria, these 9.5 million people. We're still seeing people come through the sort of central Mediterranean route, not through the eastern Mediterranean. And even if we don't see these people, almost the greater problem is the people who are trapped. So it's not problem solved if they're not coming to the EU. You know, the people who can't get out but are displaced. So I wanted to underline that because I think that the problem is brewing and I haven't seen anything yet. That leads to my answer, what I think the EU should be doing. I think it needs a change of sensibility. If I'm thinking of it in a sort of global perspective, the EU still thinks in a Western European receiving country perspective. It still looks at immigrants as poor and helpless. It doesn't realise that it's often the most able and best qualified people. And again, it doesn't see the problems for sending countries, and it doesn't see the problem for transit countries, these countries that are sort of housing the trapped population. So if I'm looking at it from a sort of outside perspective, and that would be my answer, to stop thinking in that sort of receiving
Nice. Did you want to comment on that? Yes.
In addition to those challenges or important points, I think integration, to invest in integration, because people will continue to come. And it will be a challenge. It's a challenge for them, having been forced to leave their countries for persecution, war, conflict, or economic reasons. And they will come, and I think we need to invest a lot in both at governmental, municipal level and individual level in integration in order to make this work, in order to prevent marginalization and conflicts that we see in some places. And we also see that also politicians use failed integration as an argument for restricting asylum policies and their borders. So I think that's what UNHCR I personally would call for, to really look at how can we make integration as a two-way process work, because it has to happen.
Thanks. I'd like to invite questions from all of you. Maybe you'd like to react and ask about what you've heard. So we have microphones, so just wave and we'll make sure they get to you. Yes. There is someone just beside you.
The first thing is that when we talk about arranging things and changing things in those countries up here to be able to integrate, well, that takes many, many years, but the people are coming now. And I think I would have liked to hear more about the fact that Sweden, with 1/5 of the population of the European Union, if we take 50,000 per year, it'll be a little more than that even. That would mean 2.5 million if all the others did that, and that is a much faster way. And if the European Union receives 2.5 million per year, a lot of the problems we're discussing with asylum seekers are gone. But my question is this. You haven't mentioned the elephant in the room somehow, that when we see migration inside the European Union, that is because there has been introduced a monetary union. When Robert Mundell presented the criteria for an optimal currency union, it was the most basic requirement was mobility of labor over the frontiers. And that is what we see now. This is not a failure. And it's like uniting Italy. It means that most people move north. You'll get possibly, lots of economists say this nowadays, you'll get a mezzogiorno of virtually all the Mediterranean countries. They'll be growing olives and running a tourist industry and things. If you say that there is something wrong with this, you're saying there shouldn't have been a currency union. Isn't that so?
I'm just going to yes, we'll have one more brief question and then we'll answer both of them. So in the front here. Yes, and I'll ask you to keep the questions brief and also the answers, well, so we have time for. No, it's a...
The crisis in the European Union to which all the speakers refer to, it seems to me, is the consequence of the inability of the Union to discuss and formulate policy. And of course, one has to look also, and basically, before you are able to do that, to the unanimity rule, which still exists within the European Union, as opposed to the Europe group, which can decide on a qualified majority. Now, if every country, if one single country, and I can suspect that there is one country in the European Union which would like to sabotage the European integration, if that country can apply a veto to discussion, then no decision has been, no decision can be reached, and no policy can be formulated. Thank you.
Thank you. And we have one question in the back, and I think we'll take all three, and then we'll answer, because maybe there are some common links, so we have time to answer all of them. Yes.
Hello. Yeah. Well, thank you very much to the four panelists. It was really interesting. I have a question for Karolina and to anyone else who would like to jump in. And it's mainly on search and rescue operations in the Mediterranean. So the first point I have is that it seems to me, and that emerges quite clearly from the last Amnesty International report I've read, that different Southern European countries have quite different understanding of what the notion of ship in distress is. And I mean, I'm thinking in particular at the Maltese and the Italians. For the Italians, a ship in distress, as you know, as it became pretty apparent during the Mare Nostrum operation, is simply a ship with a lot of people on board. And those were the conditions in which they were rescuing them. And the other point has to do with what you said about the fact that UNHCR is supporting the joint Frontex operations after the winding down of Mare Nostrum. And I mean, these joint Frontex operations are, you know, great because they are joint, of course, and multinational, but they are likely, as it looks now, not to be deployed in, you know, much beyond territorial waters. So how are we going to reach ships in distress in the Libyan search and rescue areas, which was something that Mare Nostrum was doing? On the other hand, though, Mare Nostrum was led by the Navy, So with, you know, a whole bunch of, by the Italian Navy, with a whole bunch of other consequences. So I'm just curious to hear from you about that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And we'll try to answer these three questions briefly so we can give some answers. Karolina, would you like to start with the last one about ships in distress? And then we'll move on to whoever wants to fill in an answer. Yes.
I think on the issue of ships in distress and under which circumstances is there a responsibility to rescue, there are international standards and conventions on this, but still a lot of awareness raising needed in order for I think countries to recognize those responsibilities and implement them in practice. This is one of the areas in which UNHCR is working. For example, within our we're having this year, we have something called the High Commissioner's Dialogue on Protection Challenges in every year in December, and then Rescue at Sea is the theme this year because of the situation in the Mediterranean, the Gulf of Aden, and so on. And one of the purposes is to raise awareness about the legal obligations in this area and what they mean in practice. When it comes to the EU search and search and rescue operation, I mean, we very much welcomed the Mare Nostrum operation that Italy put in, the Italian Coast Guard put in place after the Lampedusa catastrophe last year, and have really supported their efforts and are sad to see it now winding down. The joint operation Triton that has just been launched on the 1st of November by the EU's border agency Frontex does not have close to the same mandate and role as Mare Nostrum had. It's much more a kind of border control operation that will do some rescue, but it's mandates or responsibilities are not understood to be the same as Mare Nostrum's, which we have expressed our concern about, and we are therefore calling on the EU to put in place a proper search and rescue operation that has the broad responsibilities needed. So we, I think maybe I end there.
Yes, yeah, thank you. And who would like to answer the question about the difficulties in reaching a common way?
Well, I could turn to the first question there on monetary policy.
Yes, of the currency union. Yes,
and since I think I mentioned the elephant at least a little bit, but of course, if you when a people loses any influence on monetary policy, it also loses parts of its citizenship, because citizenship and monetary policy are very, very connected. That's also part of what it means to be a democracy. When a whole region does that with hundreds of millions of people, you of course preempt a lot of ways to resolve a crisis. I don't have to go down the list, but you know, fiscal policy and so on. So what some people, and you're right, what some people have said, well, the last safety valve then, what is that? Well, it's that people leave. The government and the country cannot deal with the crisis, which is very obvious in today's EU, so people use the sort of exit option. I mean, some stay on and protest and form new parties, like in Spain or in Greece, try to change policy. But a lot of people decide to leave. Now, in the ideal world of EU integration, and what you get in some of the textbooks is, of course, that the migration option is then linked to simply, say, factor mobility. Oh, so you have a bottleneck problem in some place, and you have too many unemployed in another. Well, it's just factor mobility, just move these people here and there. But that's not how people work. People are social creatures, first and foremost, not factors of production. And so this is then a big problem, because free movement in the EU, until Eastern enlargement and until the crisis, was something that people didn't use very much. And if you read the Commission's work from the 70s and onwards, the Commission was always so frustrated about the lack of people using free movement in the EU. People refused to move. They had the freedom, but they didn't move. And so they look at the US. People are so mobile, they just move. But in the EU, they didn't do it. Why? Because they have the right to stay. It's very simple. If you have the right to stay and feel that if I lose my job, I will still survive in this place where I have my whole social relationship established, it's a big step to move, just to leave your social location. But now, when the crisis has come, a lot of EU citizens don't feel that they have a right to stay anymore, that people are getting so grim where they live. So what do? They use the option of free movement, but they're no longer free. And that's the policy responses we see, especially when they start to talk, yeah, you might be able to continue to move freely, but you're not going to get the same rights. So we're going to cut down on that. And in that sense, the free movement regime, which gives a lot of rights to people moving, it's anachronistic because it dates back to a 1950s, 60s sort of embedded liberal period of welfare state building and so on. So that, I think, is what many governments see. Yeah, they can come and work here, but if they want to claim rights, they should be treated just as any third country national migrant and not get any specific preferences. So,
Roderick, would you like to follow up on that? And maybe you would like to comment briefly on the second question also before we wind down. Thank you.
Let me annoyingly start on the third and Marian Ostrom. You said it's joint and it's international, and that's great. I think it's joint and it's international, and that's the problem. You know, we're talking about an area where search and rescue is carried out essentially along national lines, and national lines of accountability are what we're expecting. Frontex suits member states because lines of accountability are so poor, you know, not least because it's in the middle of changing its executive director. So we have this European solution, problem solved. No, we don't. You know, Frontex is emphatically not a search and rescue organisation, and under international law, it's hard to see how it ever could be. But Italy gets to say, well, you know, we can wind down Marian Ostrom because the EU is there. The EU, of course, isn't replacing it. They're just worried about weatherproofing migrant flows across the Mediterranean. Problem solved. And for the rest of Europe, problem solved. So I would, you know, attack that a little bit and say that precisely the problem is that it's so sort of muddy. And as regards the Eurozone, again, I mean, two further problems. Firstly, the fact that the Eurozone doesn't wholly overlap with the EU's whole free movement regime, so it's a smaller number of states, and that's what I was trying to get out of my presentation, that we're facing the risk of a sort of inner core of free movements in which countries like the UK and Sweden, non-Eurozone members, and Eastern Europe are sort of pushed out a little bit. And also, I think what you were talking about it's not just the case that people in badly affected crisis Eurozone countries will stay within the EU or the Eurozone, you know, we're facing also large scale brain drain out of the EU.
Thank you. This is an interesting and important topic, and we could really go on discussing this for a long, long time, and I'm sure we'll come back to all these issues again. I'd like to thank you for your questions and for your interest and for coming here today, and I'd like to thank you for very much for interesting presentations and answers, and for giving us some of your clever thoughts on this topic. So thank you very much.